So it's actually great to do it after Jessica, because our work is so complementary. Even if mine comes from, the motivation is different, it comes from a different perspective. I am fascinated, and I'm totally, my research agenda is all about trying to go to the evolutionary root of female competitiveness. In economics, we have this idea that women don't reach the top, we don't have enough CEO, and they don't become president of the United States because women don't ask, women have a lower desire to compete. It's, you know, this different behavioral trait. Well, from an evolutionary perspective, this is really nonsense. Even musk and lichens compete. It's not possible that a living being doesn't compete. What is happening is that we do competition in a very different ways. So if we go back to the evolutionary model of our psyche and our psychology evolved since the Pleistocene, men compete in a dimension and women compete on a different dimension. There are two different ways of, two different spheres of competition. There is competition for mate and there is competition for the offspring well-being. And in both cases, male and women do it differently. So if we use the same experimental instrument to measure competitiveness, like we would measure temperature, and we use the same instrument for a man and we apply it to a woman, no surprise that we are gonna find that women have a lower desire to compete and they don't ask and they do all these different things less than they do to a man. But do the game a little bit different, put in the game something for which women are really good at, and then we're gonna see a very different result. So this study really stemmed from having, in evolutionary theory, having an idea that the way women are mated, the way marriage systems are, should have a profound effect on the way in which women strategically compete. And working on competition, you realize that while for men, competition and cooperation might be different and more competitive men could be less competitive, but that is not necessarily so because we have all the models of the band of brothers. You see that for women, being cooperative is actually key to being competitive. Competition is a cooperative strategy. This is due to the need of having allomaternal care. The business of bringing to maturity these big brain babies is something that a woman cannot do on her own. While mama cats can do it, can produce enough calories to feed their kittens, a woman simply cannot. She needs to have the resources in terms of resources and time, possibly from the father, but also from the others, the other people. It really does take a village. So for women, this is the key. Cooperation is part of strategic competition. So how better to check into these ideas, into looking in monogamous, women that are into monogamous and marriage versus those that are in polygynous. Union. This work is in collaboration with Monique Borgeroff-Mulder and Christina Moya. We are two anthropologists at UC Davis, my colleague Janusz Stopnicki, and my student Bethany Gerderman. So since Jessica did a great job with the literature on bargaining and household, I will not even go. I will not even go on that literature, but I prefer to just talk about this evolutionary. So what we have here, the field studies Sierra Leone, where we have between 20 and 50%, because these unions are really so fluid that we cannot have a precise number. It's 20 to 50% of marriages are polygynous across the polygynous belt of Africa. And what we have, one in four women are in polygynous union, and in Sierra Leone in particular, we have between 35 and 55 of the women versus 20% of the men that are in polygynous marriages. I won't even go over the literature that Jessica covered, only say that economic research is really concerned with household efficiency, and which we measure through public good games. But I was interested in individual behavior, so I didn't do a public good game. I did a series of competitive games and a series of dictator games. And so let's start, I will describe the games in a moment. Let's start with some summary statistics and see who are the people in my sample. So first of all, we randomly picked two of the four regions of Sierra Leone, Makeni and Kenema. And in each one, we sampled randomly seven villages. And in the villages, we did a classic classic sampling strategy in which we start from the center of the town, we go every third house, and if all of them could come and participate in the experiment, they were in. This was our sampling strategy, and 99% of the household that we asked to, they joined. These were extremely poor. We had a good incentive, and people were very cooperative with us, so we don't have much bias into that. We end up having 108 polygynous household, with mostly one husband and two wives, and only 8 managed to bring along a third wife, so I don't want to say too much about second wife versus third wife. And we have 121 monogamous household. And what do we have in terms of difference? Well, in terms of monogamous people, the men are significantly 10 years older, and they have a higher level of education than their wives. When it comes to polygynous women and men, we have the polygynous men are significantly older than the wives. They have higher education, and they have twice as many children. And when it comes to comparison, monogamous women, polygynous women, there is whatsoever no difference. In fact, if we think about this, I mean, the Achilles heel is really endogeneity. Thing is, for women, it is kind of an exogenous thing, because if the husband decides to take a second wife or a third wife, provided that all the permission and all the costume are respected, there is very little that the first wife can say. So for at least for the women, it's a slightly more exogenous being in monogamy versus in polygyny, while for men, it is more of a choice, although it is expected that when you reach a certain level of status and wealth, you will take on more wife. So let's start with our series of dictators games. There are 4 of them: the sharing game, the costless sharing game, the envy, and the costless envy. Those are the classic from Ernst Fehr. And in each one, one option is always to split 50-50. In this case, it was 5,000 leones for yourself and for the other person. In the sharing game is, do you want to do 5,000, 5,000, or 10,000 for yourself and 0 for the other. In the costless sharing, it is 5,000, 5,000 versus 5,000 for yourself. So for the same, for the person is exactly the same, but it's just 0 for the other person. In the envy game, it's 5,000, 5,000, and 10,000 now for me, but 30,000 for you. And in the costless envy, it is 5,000, 5,000, and 5,000, and 10,000 for the other person. So in the costless game, the payoff for me is absolutely identical. What changes is the payoff, the amount of money that I give to the other. And we play these 4 sets of game with everyone. We play with an anonymous person from the same village, the stranger, with the spouse, so every man with all the spouses, every woman with both the spouse and all of the co-wives. We also did competitive games, but I cannot crash into 20 minutes all of this, but if you're curious, ask me, and I'll tell you the result about competitiveness, which is actually the motivation for the entire study. But here I need more help, so I prefer to present the stuff where I feel... Okay, so let's go into the result. So what do we find in terms of cooperation? That both monogamous and polygynous men and monogamous and polygynous women are really more generous. So let's look, The first things, the really easy things that we can check, let's take the sharing and the costless sharing. And let's look at the difference between the blue bar, which is the stranger condition, versus the red bar, which is the spouse. And what do we see? That really polygynous people cooperate more. I find in my case that they cooperate more with a spouse than with a stranger. Maybe cooperating with a stranger is really a low bar. Maybe we would expect a lot more. It's sure not 100%, but it is more than the 50%. It's a different game. Your includes some amount of trust. In mine is purely an allocation of resources. But we do find, and this is always statistically significant. So polygynous people, they really do cooperate with their spouse. They share a lot more with their spouse, both when it's costly and when it is costless. Co-wives, from a female point of view, is a different story. Co-wives are treated closer to stranger than closer to closer to their husband. And when it comes to envy, so here in this case, would you pay to make sure that you are egalitarian, that you have the same division of resources than your spouse? Well, we find the polygynous people are actually less envious than monogamous people. They do not waste resources, except female dealing with co-wives, in which no, they really want to be egalitarian, and even more so, slightly significantly more so than a stranger. And when it is costless, look at the difference. The difference becomes even stronger. So what I have in, from the basic games, which now I aggregate into types, I have that polygynous people in polygynous union are better at doing business. They are not hung up on egalitarianism. The more resources, the better. So let's now put them into type. So these are all testing for the statistical significance, and we see that both monogamous men and women share more. It's significant. All what that I said, it just, even when you control, it works. And this is true also for the wives. So polygynous men are more generous and less envious toward their wives than the stranger. What I find, though, is that they treat their wives similarly, so similarly to what you get, the treatment, this similar to what you get. I found that they really do treat their wives all the same. Wife three is possibly worse, but I have only 8 observations, so I don't want to say much about it. I use it only as a control. So now the interesting part is going to be putting everything together and checking at the gap. So when it comes, we have many gaps that we are interested in. Gaps in terms of women, monopoly, men, monopoly. Gaps in terms of monogamy. Is there a gap? Is there a gender gap in cooperation between women and men? We can look at it in a different, in so many ways. I want to go, though, at, because I want to stay within my allotted time. Oh, I have plenty of time. I thought I was almost over. So let me go back. I are gonna get it all. So let's look at the gap for men and women. So polygynous people are less envious towards the spouse than the monogamous people. And there is no monogamy polygyny gap in sharing. And we have that the polygynous women are more envious, are the most envious, really, of the co-wives. Let's see what is significance or not. And let's start with the mono and poly men. So this is the first gap that we look at, polygyny or monogamy per characters. So the first one are the men. What do we have? That when it comes to sharing, so in this panel, we have the stranger. So the same game, stranger versus the wife. And we have that polygynous men share more with a wife than with a stranger, both when it's costly and when it is costless. They are less envious with their spouse than with a stranger, both when it's costly and when it is costless. And what do we observe? That when we just compare the games by themselves, stranger condition versus wife condition, there is really no difference. Polygyny really doesn't make a difference. In a way similar to what you find, monogamous men and polygynous men are not that different when it comes to this game. Let's look at the women, though. What happens to the women? Everything is very similar. Polygyny itself does not make much of a difference in terms of what the women do with respect to the wife. With respect to the stranger, everybody does the same. The only exception, which is very important, is the one in terms of envy. And what do we observe? That polygynous women, when they play with their husband, are less envious. They don't need to be egalitarian. They choose the equal split less than the monogamous one. So let's put all of this game together, because this is the main goal, is putting these four games together and creating types. Many types can be created The most important one, the most relevant one, at least the one that have been studied more in the literature, are maximizer. Who is a maximizer? A maximizer would be one that in the costly share is the same because the total is always equal to two. I just simplify the payoff. But in the maximizer, it chooses the distribution that gives the most for the two person. So in a way, it is the one that is the most efficient in terms of a household. Then instead we have the egalitarian, where always picks the 1-1. We can have egalitarian with only the two costly game, or the egalitarian with all the four games when we have four of them together. Then we have the generous. The generous type is the one that always maximizes the payoff for the other person. Then we have the selfish type, the person that always gets the most for self. And then we have the spiteful type, the one that no matter what always pick for the other person to have the least. And what are our results? And our results are statistically significant that when it comes to egalitarianism, let's start with the male, it's very similar. When it comes to egalitarianism, monogamous male are significantly more egalitarian than polygynous male, both in the stranger condition and in the spouse condition. For female, it is the same. They are more egalitarian in the stranger condition and even more so in the polygynous condition, but less egalitarian, but not with the co-wives for which they are as egalitarian as they want to be with a stranger. When it comes to maximizing the overall resources, what do we have? That all of them, whether they are monogamous or polygynous, they do maximize resources with their spouse a lot more than they do with a stranger. So at least at the very basic idea that a marriage is to create some sort of, is for the household production more than that, what you just would do with a stranger, just being like cats, yes. Marriages are good. People do produce more and they within their spouse, because then there is the co-wives. And with the co-wives, again, they are treated only barely better than they treat a stranger. Significantly more than a stranger. The co-wives are really these things in the middle. When it comes to generosity, it doesn't even register as a type. In the stranger condition, nobody's generous, is generous with a stranger, but look about with their spouse. Everyone is generous with their spouse, significantly more than with a stranger. And polygynous people are more generous with their spouse than the monogamous people. And polygynous women are more generous with their co-wives than they would do towards a stranger. So generosity definitely is there. Let's look at selfishness. Who are the selfish one? Well, it's really in the stranger condition. There is a lot more selfishness with stranger than with spouse. There is no much difference between men, monopoly, or female monopoly, except that the female polygynous are more selfish with their spouse. So in this case, being selfish with the spouse is in between the stranger condition and the co-wives. Spitefulness, where you really want to, you don't care, even if you're losing resources, you just want the other person to have left. What do we have? The most spite is really for female with their polygynous co-wives. And all of that I said, we can check whether it is significant. So when we see that, so in this case, we have just the stranger condition, being female, being in polygyny, it really doesn't matter. With stranger, all our actors behave exactly the same. With spouse, what do we have? That polygynous people are significantly so less egalitarian, more maximizer, more generous, and more spiteful. And for selfishness, the polygynous people or monogamous people are exactly the same. Let's now look at the various gaps. So with men, let's check what they do with their spouse. Polygynous men they are maximizer and generous with their spouse. So this goes back to the idea that maybe is contrary to common wisdom that polygynous men are like the king in this harem of women and do whatever they want. Absolutely not, because if they don't treat them well, they are gonna go. So they have to treat them well. They treat them better than the monogamous man. If they want to keep them around, they have to treat them better. And polygynous women do the same. They treat their husband better in terms of resources than their monogamous counterpart. This was the part that I found that it is conform to the model that you were just referring to. And I was totally surprised because I came with this idea that I would have found the opposite. But ethnographic report about the Temne, the vast majority of my subject here are Temne, they say because we look at polygyny with our maybe Western lens, and we kind of find pity for the women that are married polygynously. But that is not so, because it's just a normal, regular fact of life. There is no pity whatsoever. What is the value of a husband? Not so much for a woman. What is the value of a wife? Not so much. What they care about is the production of the resources, of making a living, and definitely making a living if married is so much easier than making a living alone. But there is no this preconceived ideas that we might have find. So polygynous people, look at that. For when it comes to women, polygynous women are less egalitarian towards the spouse, but more maximizer, more generous. They are also more selfish and more spiteful. There is so many ways in which I can slice the data. I can talk about the relationship between the co-wives, where I can see how do the women treat their co-wives versus their spouse. They are more egalitarian. See, they treat them like a stranger. They are less maximizer, less generous, but they are also less selfish and also more spiteful. And what do they are? They are especially behind the verse. They do not want to have less than their co-wives. So, in conclusion, polygynous women cooperate more with their spouse than monogamous women, who cooperate more with their spouse than with their co-wives. This is similar to the stranger condition. Polygynous men cooperate more with the spouse than the monogamous men, and they seem to treat each other similarly. So everyone in our sample treat their spouse and sometimes co-wives even better than they treat stranger. And this is really good that marriage is some form of division of labor, and it is where a collective good is produced. And so there is this idea that polygynous households fail at maximizing resources. Well, not in my data set, not in my work. And this is maybe the difference with your work and with the work of Berber. Although we are doing different games, you both did the public good game, and I did a series of prisoner's dilemma game. So for in my sample, these polygynous households are better at maximizing resources. And they don't treat second wife differently than first wife.
All right, to see these two talks back to back, I just had two quick questions. The first one was, you grouped the first and second and third wives together when you look at polygynous versus monogamous, and I was wondering if you had more of a breakdown,
yes,
the way Jess did, about first to second and second to first. That was the first question. And then the second one was the thing that was just nagging at me throughout, is trying to understand the selection into monogamous and polygynous. And I know it's really hard to get at in a cross section, but I just don't know if there's any other work that shows that people with certain sort of sharing tendencies or cooperative tendencies are a little bit more or less likely to become polygynous. Because some of the interpretation you showed, where you said, oh, polygynous men are in this setting and that makes them more cooperative with their wives, I was thinking, well, maybe men with certain characteristics take on more wives. So those are just my two.
These are both excellent points. Regarding the first one, I bunch them together with average cooperation or average type per wives, because when I do the analysis per wife, so isolating first wife and second wives, and forget about this 8 data point with the third wife, I find whatsoever no difference. And here there are I could slice the data in so many ways, because there are 4 games for so many people. So you can create many, many different models, and this one seems to be the most succinct, but maybe it's important to keep them separate. So I should keep the analysis separate, but I find no difference whatsoever whether the recipient is the first or second wife, no difference whatsoever whether the sender is the first of the second wives. It seems like they are really interchangeable. The second part is really the Achilles heel of this work, because it's totally, what do we observe? Here we observe, first of all, the household that even managed to be all together and participating all together. So we observe the functional one, and the functional one probably are functional because it's possible that they are functional because of these characteristics. So next is how do you disentangle this, and how do you find? So we should see, we are trying actually to look at if there is something that would predict whether a man is polygynous or not, like in terms of wealth, in terms of education, in terms of age, in terms of ethnicity, and see if you can use that as an instrument for polygyny. But so far, we are just doing the dirty job of comparing the successful polygynous union with a successful monogamous union.
A question actually for both of you, if you could speak a little bit to the setting as to whether or not these polygynous unions are living in the same compounds, or if you took a look at, if you took a look at the role of distance from each other, or if there's variation in that setup.
So all of the families in my work, they are all staying in the same compound. So sometimes the second wife will have a second hut, essentially, but they're all on the same compound.
Same in mine. Sometimes you would have the town wife and the country wife, where the husband has both a small business and also a plot of land, and so has a wife that does the weeding and the other one that does a bit of trading. But most of them live all in the same compound.
I had a question too, but to your question about whether we see differences in characteristics, in my data, and it looks like in yours, we saw no differences in contributions to the stranger.
Yeah.
I also had risk preferences, time preferences, trust in your spouse, trust in, we saw absolutely no differences across characteristics. Yeah, so my question was, and I don't think you mentioned it, is your population mostly agricultural?
Yes.
See, this is something I really want to know more about, because in Berber's paper also, that's an agricultural setting. In the Monroe et al. Paper, that's an agricultural setting. Yours is an agricultural setting. In yours and Berber's, you find that polygynous households are more efficient, more cooperative, whereas in mine, a pastoralist, we find no differences. Now, Monroe also sees no differences, but I'm really curious about
key.
This agricultural pastoralist difference, and I don't have data to test that theory, so someone else should go out and do that.
Yeah, no, that would be fantastic. No, that is key. You know, that is key, the form of subsistence. Another thing that it is interesting is monogamy. Monogamy, from an evolutionary, just to be complementary in this, monogamy is really a puzzle. It's really the puzzle of monogamous marriage, because from an evolutionary perspective, both men and women, it is evolutionary advantageous to be polygynous for men. It means increased fitness because it increases a higher number of children. And we do observe from the summary statistic that polygynous men, they do have more children. For women, there isn't a competition in terms of, you know, more children, because supposedly there is a maximum limit number of children that women can have. Men is different. Julius Caesar supposedly had 500 children. Emperors of China had harems of 1,000 wives, and who knows how many children did they have. So for men, it's evolutionary advantageous to be polygynous. For women, not so much, because we cannot have 1,000 children. Although for women, it's very important to have resources. And it seems like the polygyny threshold model and others that, again, maybe it's better to be married from a rich guy than being the only wife of a really poor man. And yet, monogamy is resisting. It is spreading throughout the world. Why is it so? This is a puzzle, the puzzle of monogamy. And the reason, at least an hypothesis that I find really fascinating, it goes back to the intergroup competition. If the unit of selection, more than the individual, is really the group, there are ways in which we do group competition, which is warfare, but there are other ways in which we do group competition, which is simply out-competing by doing better, like companies, by having more profit, by producing more. And what does monogamy does to society? If not to the people in the union, monogamy is beneficial to society because you don't have this large number of incels, of men that cannot find a wife, and so you have less violence, less violent behavior, you have less problem at the societal level. Better outcome for the children, and this might make a group outcompete another in terms of outcomes, of better outcomes. This is really interesting because you see the tension between selection at the individual level and selection at the group level, and the constant negotiation that individuals and group do. But this could be really another way to go at the roots of human cooperation.
Quick question on trying to get that identification and maybe being able to look not only at individual behavior, but also the societal outcomes. You showed in your first map, I think, that there is this polygynous belt. Is that right?
Yeah.
Would it be possible to do like Sarah Lowe's did for the matrilineal belt and run experiments on each side of the border in a way?
There is so much work that needs to be done. Absolutely. It would be fantastic to do it like that. So maybe both of our work inspires some people here to go and do it. I mean, there are so many ways in which one you can attract. I think we need a lot more data on this because it's really interesting and we can learn so much.